This is an admission H&P. It contains 148 words. To figure out what it's worth, we need to figure out the level of care by taking apart the history, the exam, and the medical decision-making, and plugging that information into this table, which shows the documentation requirements for admission H&Ps. For these encounters, all three key components are needed. You can use either the 95 or the 97 guidelines. In this case, the 95 guidelines work out better for the doctor. Starting with the history, this is the table we use to figure out what level of history has been recorded. Here we have a valid sheep complaint. Looking at the HPI, we see the patient presents with 2-day history of severe intermittent chest pain associated with worsening lower extremity edema. So here we've commented on the duration of the problem, the severity, the timing, and associated signs or symptoms. This adds up to 4 HPI elements, which means we qualify for an extended HPI. The next step is to check the PFSH. Looking at the PFSH, you see that at least one element from the past medical, social, and family history is recorded, which means we have a 3 out of 3 PFSH. The next step is to check the ROS. Looking at the ROS, here we see the most clinically relevant systems have been documented, along with the notation, otherwise negative except per HPI. And here we have a problem. Obviously, the doctor is trying to utilize the accepted ROS shortcut, which is recognized by both the 95 and 97 A&M guidelines. But there's a mistake made here that I see often. This shortcut is very specific and clearly states that the physician must indicate that all other systems were reviewed and are negative. This notation here does not satisfy this requirement because the statement otherwise negative does not explicitly confirm that all the other systems were reviewed. It just implies that no information came up in any of the additional systems reviewed, which is clinically informative. There's no way to tell how many additional systems are accounted for. I know this sounds like a trivial issue of semantics, but I promise you that many auditors will disallow this shortcut if there is any ambiguity whatsoever. In this case, the auditor may only give credit for the 3 systems actually reviewed. As we'll see in a minute, this mistake will gut the entire history. Looking at the total history now, here we have an extended HPI, 3 out of 3 components of PFSH, but only 3 systems reviewed. That means because of this ROS mistake we made, we can't qualify for a comprehensive history. We can only qualify for a detailed history. So now the first key component is known. The next step is to check the physical exam. Looking at the exam and using the 1995 guidelines, we see that information is recorded about the constitutional system, the eyes, the respiratory system, the cardiovascular system, the GI system, the musculoskeletal system, the skin, and the psychiatric system. This gives us 8 organ systems, which means this qualifies as a comprehensive physical exam. So now the second key component is known. The last step is to check the medical decision-making. Looking at the medical decision-making, and starting with the problem points first, both the CAD and CHF would count as new problems for which additional workup is planned. Therefore, they're each worth 4 points, which gives us a total of 8 problem points. The next step is to check the data points. Looking at the data points, here we get 1 data point for reviewing labs, 2 data points for eyeballing the EKG, 1 data point for looking at the chest X-ray report. That gives us a total of 4 data points. The next step is to check the risk. Looking at the risk, in this patient, both the CAD and CHF would probably count as acute or chronic illnesses which may pose a threat to life or bodily function. Therefore, I think this is a high-risk encounter. So when you put it all together, only 2 out of 3 dimensions are needed, but in this case, all 3 dimensions point us toward high-complexity medical decision-making. So now the final key component is known. Now that we know the key components, we can figure out what level of care has been recorded. Here we have a detailed history, a comprehensive exam, and high-complexity medical decision-making. For these encounters, 3 out of 3 key components are needed. That is, each key component must meet or exceed the requirements for any given level of care. In this case, the note was ruined by the ROS mistake, which broke the history. Therefore, we only qualify for the 99221 level of care. When you put it all together, this is how the final note looks. 3 out of 3 key components are needed, and here we have a detailed history, a comprehensive exam, and high complexity medical decision making. So this note took 148 words to create, and we all know it should be a level 3 H&P, in which case we would have been paid $194, or $1.31 per word. But because of that ROS mistake, we would only get paid for level 1 H&P, which pays $97, or about 67 cents per word. So remember the magic words, all other systems reviewed and are negative. If you want to learn how to take apart a note like this, consider signing up for one of our web-based D&M coding curriculums. We offer several different subscription options to match any practice pattern. We also have a coder curriculum, which includes up to 33 AAPC CEUs for only $99. If you need E&M coding education from multiple providers, ask about an E&M compliance web portal, which provides trackable and verifiable E&M coding education for multiple doctors.